I want to talk about a subject today. This is not a very popular subject. I'm just going to let you know right off the bat, this is not a popular subject. But that's okay, because I believe that this subject is important. It's not just important to me. I believe it's important to God. And I could hear a mouse talk in this church. It helps the preacher, just to let you know, it helps the preacher when you talk back. Not talk back in a derogatory manner, but when you say amen, or you clap, or you say go ahead, preacher, or you say shut your mouth, I don't want to hear about it. Anything like that, a response, really encourages the preacher. Amen? Amen. Whew. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. Again, this is not a, thank you, Frenchie. This is not an easy subject, but here's the thing is, it took probably Tina and I a good 8 to 10 years to really learn this and apply this in our lives and in our marriage. And I want you to know today, I'm not going to talk about money because we need money. Okay, God is, y'all are generous, and I thank you for that. I thank you that you are generous in honoring God. It's not that you're not honoring me, and you're not trying to do something for me. You're honoring God by what you do. And that's why we can do things like what Salt and Light did and provide for the community and those that are in need. Amen? And so I just want you to know that this is a subject that have people bound. We're in this chain breaker series. We're talking about Jesus is the chain breaker, right? I mean, do we know that? Have we learned that in these 10 weeks or so that we've been talking specifically about him being a chain breaker? He will break chains of bondage off of your life. He'll break chains of domination in your life. And he will expose you to things in your life. He'll unchain you to the point to where you can actually stand and you can lift your hands, because that is a form. That's one thing that people, they get bound up and they're like, I can't do that. I can't lift my hands in church. But we can lift our hands and we can shout and we can clap at a ball game, or we can lift our hands and we can shout at a concert, but we can't lift our hands and shout in church. This ain't even why I'm here to preach today. This ain't even what I'm preaching today. I'm just saying that we people live bound up. We live bound up in religiosity, and it keeps us from being who God has called us to be and walking in what God has called us to walk in. Now, listen, if you're not a hand raiser, that's okay. I'm just, you know, I just want you to know that, hey, if you'll do like that, it'll get you just a little bit closer to heaven. So if you really want to get closer to heaven, you're closer like this than you are like this. I'm just saying, that's just free stuff. That's for y'all, right? But that's not what I'm here to talk about. The number one cause of divorce in America, can anybody guess? Finances. The number one cause of divorce. It's not adultery. You know, if you might think that. You might say, you know, surely it's infidelity or something. No, it's not. The number one cause of divorce in America is over finances. And here's the thing is, as I did a little bit of research on this, I saw something in Scripture this week that I'd never really realized. It's some wording that is in Scripture, and I probably read right over it. But we do that a lot of times. And I think sometimes God purposely doesn't let us see things until we're ready. Okay, until we are ready to hear that or to see that or to read that, I think a lot of times we do that. But here's the thing. God really showed me something in Scripture today, and I want you to see it. Because it took me and Tina, like I said, 8 to 10 years before we really trusted. Now, listen, she grew up under the Word, all right? Everybody knows her daddy was the pastor here. And so her entire life, for all of her 29 years of living, she has grown up in, you see, y'all ain't even listening to me. Y'all have turned your ears off. You see, that tells me something. that as soon as the preacher starts talking about money, you go to sleep. You close your eyes and you start taking a nap. So for all of her life, she has known. She was taught to be a giver as a child. We taught our children how to be givers, how to be tithers. But here's the thing is it's up to the individual person. Because the first probably 8 to 10 years of our marriage, we really... Let me back that up. It was my fault. All right? It's my fault. Because she wanted so much to be a giver. She wanted so much to honor God with our finances, but we chose not to. Or I chose. I keep saying we, but we are one. Here's the thing. We are one, right? Let me just say this, because this is how strongly it is. It is a mindset. I was bound in a mindset of poverty. Okay? Do y'all hear that? Those that are watching on the live, do you hear that? I lived in a mindset of poverty. And in that poverty, that mindset of poverty, it kept me from being blessed. Did y'all hear that? That mindset that I lived in kept us and our family from being blessed. Okay? And here's the thing. It's so easy to see this in Scripture. And let me just add this because I wrote it on my notes. And it's just unfathomable, these numbers. Now, this is a poll from 2018. In the year 2018, in all of 2018, just in America alone, Americans are bound to over $1 trillion, that's trillion with a T, $1 trillion in credit card debt. $1 trillion. I would love to have a tithe off of a trillion. Americans in 2018, I know we're in 2020, but this is just the latest numbers that I've seen. In 2018, Americans were also bound to $2.8 trillion in non-revolving debt. In other words, loans. $2.8 trillion. I want you to know something today. Because, I mean, Tina and I have started something. We've adjusted our mindset, and we are dead set to get out of debt God's way. We could make some very drastic decisions in our life, and we could do some things that are really unorthodox, but that doesn't honor God. And so what we want to do is we want to honor God. We've been tithers. I'm just letting you know that we've been tithers probably for the last close to 20 years. Faithful, God-honoring tithers that are honoring what God says in His Word. Okay? And I'm not boasting about what we do. But we have selected some ministries that we can see God's hand on. I mean, we can see God blessing these ministries and using these ministries, not just in a financial way, but to set people free. To set people free from religion and bondage and denomination and whatever it is that is controlling them. And so we have chosen to sow seeds into those ministries. This is above and beyond our tithe. I believe the tithe belongs in the local church. I believe, and I'll show you in Scripture that the tithe belongs in your church, in your home church. But then there's something else in there that's called offerings. And this is the thing, is that a lot of times, and the way that I have heard this preached, and the way that I've even preached this, I preached it really totally different, and I have even heard it preached totally different. But I want to ask you this question today. Do you want God to bless you? It's very simple. Don't even think about money, but just think about the generality of being blessed. Do you want God to bless you? Absolutely. Who doesn't want to be blessed? I want to be blessed. And I mean, it has nothing to do, listen, nothing to do with finances. I want to be blessed with the blessing of God on my life. I want the blessing of God on our ministry. I want the blessing of God on the things that I say, the things that I do. I want the blessings of God. And here's the thing is that when we choose to be disobedient in any area of our life, we move out of the blessings of God and we set ourselves under a curse. Now listen, before you get mad, God does not curse you. Did y'all hear that? God does not curse you. But we put it on ourselves. It's there. It's there for the choosing. Okay, we can choose the blessing or we can choose the curse. It's no different. It's no different than salvation. God does not send people to hell. We send ourselves to hell. When people choose not to receive Christ as their Savior, you basically say, God, you're not good enough for me. I choose this other way. It's a simple decision. But I want the blessings of God, and I never saw this it's okay if I come down. I don't need notes for this subject. I don't need notes for this subject because I live this in my life. And you say, well, what about all them other sermons you preach and you need notes? You must not live that way. I don't want to forget things that I say. But this is a very simple subject. This is just the simplicity of this subject is ridiculous. When we choose to honor God, the obedience in honoring Him and the blessing that comes with it. Now, again, I'm not telling everybody that's in this room, and even some that are watching us, and I'm saying this, y'all are generous. And I'm so thankful because you understand. I believe you understand what I'm saying, but the reason I'm preaching this is because there are people that are bound and they are not walking in the blessings of God as a result of that. So please, everybody, y'all put a smile on your face because y'all looking at me like, why did I even show up today? Y'all smile a little bit. I like to see your teeth. I hope you brushed them. But I know that there's some people that are watching us today that people need to be set free from this subject that I'm going to talk about here. It took me a long time to get set free. I told y'all that. Nearly 10 years it took me before I understood and got set free. And I have seen nothing but the blessings of God in my life as a result of the obedience that I learned. And when I learned that and I started seeing the multiplication of what God can do with just a little bit of faith, Frenchie. A mustard seed of faith. That's what the word says, right? A mustard seed of faith. In other words, he's saying just a tiny, tiny, tiny little bit of faith. And then God begins to multiply it through obedience. You can't listen. I heard a preacher talk about it like this. You and me, we work in in addition and subtraction, but God works in multiplication. And God can take just a little bit of obedience and He can multiply that obedience to something that we can't even possibly fathom. But here's the thing. I look at this verse of Scripture. And I've heard preachers preach this verse of Scripture and use this verse of Scripture in a condemning way, in a religious and a condemning way. And I have probably done it too. I cannot eject myself from that. I probably have done it. I haven't done it in a very, very long time. I can tell you that because I understand this. But in Malachi 3:8, it says, will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me, but you say, in what way have we robbed you? And it says, in tithes and offerings. Now, here's the thing is that a lot of preachers have taken that verse of Scripture and used it in a condemning way and try to hold it over their people and say, if you're not tithing, if you're not giving to God, then you are robbing God. And that's the furthest thing from the truth. I want you to know this today, that that is the furthest thing from the truth, because God don't need your money. Okay, this side of the church understands. Let me tell this side, and all those that are watching, God don't need your money.
Amen.
Amen. God doesn't need your money. He owns the cattle on a thousand hills and the hills also. He doesn't need your money. But when it, listen, because he, here's the thing. This is the condemnation that preachers do this. And they say, well, you know, we can't, and listen, I've done this. You can go back and you can rewind the third, and you don't rewind tapes anymore, you just back up the video. But you can go back and you can hear, you know, we can't do this because of this. We can't do, I've said it. I know it. I've said it. And I'm asking God, and I ask God, forgive me, please, from having that mindset. And listen to me. Listen to me. God is not trying to build something in heaven, and he needs a loan from you. Okay? We do that. This word here, it's interesting, because as I look at it, and it says, God, will a man rob God? And he says, you have robbed me in tithes and offerings. The scriptures only talk about what is God's is the tithe. In Leviticus 27:30, you got that scripture? Leviticus 27:30? All the tithe of the land, whether it's of the seed or the land of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. You'll never see in scripture that it says that the offering is the Lord's. There are gobs and gobs. I don't even know what the amount is. It's too many for me to even add up, and certainly we don't have enough hours in the day for me to go through every single scripture and to show you in scripture where it talks about all the different offerings that there are. There's praise offerings, there's clap offerings, there's heave offerings. And there's an interesting word that it talks about numerous times in the scripture, and it's called free will tithe. It's a free will offering, I mean. It's called a free will offering. And so anytime you bring an offering to the Lord, which by the way, you have to give the tithe before you give an offering. I'm just saying that, okay? But here's the thing is that people, and I've even used this verbiage or this way of speaking. I've got to pay my tithe. You don't pay a tithe. I'm sorry. There's no such thing. You don't pay a tithe, but you return what already belongs to the Lord. It ain't yours. I'm just, you know, I worked 40, 60, 80, 100 hours this week, and I earned that paycheck. That is mine. Where do you think that you got the breath that is in your lungs that gave you the ability to wake up? Where do you think you got the knowledge or the ability? Oh, well, I went to school and I earned a degree. Where do you think that your capacity to get that degree came from? Let's get down to the nitty-gritty. Let's just get down to the basics, okay? Because it's all from God, every bit of it. And that's just one scripture, that Leviticus 27:30, one scripture that I show you. The word is full of it. It's not full of it, but it's full of scripture that says that the tithe belongs to the Lord. But the offering is something that we freely give. It's something that's above. Now, I'm going to show you here in just a minute that I believe the tithe belongs in the local church. I believe it belongs at your local house, okay, your local church. But then offerings are free will offerings. They can go really anywhere. It can go into that church, into that storehouse. It can go really. And I mean, like I said, me and Tina have prayed, and we have found some church, or some, not churches, but some ministries that we believe God is blessing, and we're choosing to bless them. that ministry so that the blessings that fall on that ministry are reciprocated into our life as well because of the obedience that we've chose to honor God with the, with what we have. And so that's what we do. But when we look at this, he says, you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. How do you rob God when he doesn't need your money? I believe it's in the very next portion. Okay, so he says in verse 10, he says, bring all of the tithes. He didn't say bring all the tithes and the offerings. Here's the interesting thing. This is where, this is things get, something's going on here. Because it says, will you rob God? It says, yes, in tithes and offerings. But then he tells us, he says, just bring the tithes into the storehouse so that there will be food in my house. Okay, I believe that he's talking about the church here. He's talking about the storehouse. In other words, we are the storehouse right here in Port Acres, okay? I know there are many storehouses in Port Acres, but I'm talking to those that call New Covenant their home. We are their home ministry. We are their home church. So therefore, we are the storehouse for that individual or that family. And he says here that there will be food in my house. Food, the word of God. In other words, bring the tithe into the storehouse, into the church, so that the word, the food of God can go out in that place and bring nourishment into your life. How many people need nourishment in your life? I need nourishment in my life. I need the food. I need the word of God. Now listen, I want to take you back. I want to take you back. Does God need your money? Let me tell you something. God, if God can send ravens to feed Elijah at the brook, do you think that he needs your tithe so that the word can go out? Now, we utilize the finances that come into this church, I believe, very wisely. I have positioned some very wise people above me. Some of them are in this room. Some of them are not. But some very wise people to help utilize what comes in a very efficient and godly manner, and that will bless him at the same time. Yes, I do get paid. I am paid through that tithe. I could take it, and I'm not going to do it today, but there is scripture in Leviticus that God says, take care of the man that sends out the word. Okay? So, we're not going to do that, but I want you to be set free. If you are bound up, And like I say, I'm looking through this audience right now, and I don't think anybody in here is bound. But there are people that are going to hear this, whether it is today, or maybe it's next week, or maybe it's next month, when they go back and they watch this off of YouTube. And they say, you know what, I've been living bound up for a long time, and I want to be set free. And so the information that I'm giving you today, maybe you can share with someone that you know is bound up, and you want to see them be in the freedom that you have. But here in the scripture, he says, try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. Now, I have preached for a long time because the next verse of scripture says, and, so that means the and means that what's going to come after that goes with what went before that, right? Okay, so I have preached for a long time, just tithe so that he'll rebuke the devourer for your sake. I preached in that manner for a very long time. Just give to God so that he'll rebuke the devourer for your sake. And I have neglected to, because I haven't really paid that close of attention, I have neglected to tell you what it says right before it. The blessing that goes with the obedience of bringing the tithe into the storehouse. How many people want to be blessed? I want to be blessed. Do you want the blessings of God on your life? Not just your finances, but your life. Everything that goes with that. I want the blessings of God. And I am thankful that I am at that place in my life where I honor God with not just 10%, but everything that I have. And as a result, I see the blessings of God on my life. Now, am I walking down streets of gold, and you know, and do I have, you know, reach in to get my keys and hundreds fall out on the ground? I mean, I could if I wanted to. I just don't carry cash. You know, I use a card everywhere I go. I give my tithe on the app. Which, by the way, if you don't have our mobile app, download it. It's a free download. There's a little plug for you. It's a free download. Teresa keeps our app up to date. You can give through that app. You can watch church through that app. Praise God for technology. Anyway, blessing. I believe that when you honor God, here's the thing, you're not robbing money from him. I believe you're robbing him of the opportunity to bless your life. That's what I see in this. When you choose to withhold what is already his, I showed you one verse of scripture that says all of the tithe is his. When you choose to withhold that, you're not robbing money from him. I believe you're robbing him of the opportunity to bless you. God wants to bless you. Trust me, God wants to bless your life. But when we choose to be in disobedience against his word, you're not going to have the blessing. You're going to have the curse. Listen, and listen to what he says here. He says, let me back up because I didn't read that verse. I skipped over 9. I apologize for skipping a verse. He says, will a man rob God? And then, yet you have robbed me, but you say, in what way have we robbed you? It says, in tithes and offerings, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Again, not robbed him of money, but robbed him of the opportunity to bless him. And I do want the blessings of God on my life. But look what he continues to say. He says, when you choose to do this, when you choose to bring the tithes into the storehouse, into the church, into the house of God, that there will be food in my house. In other words, you, when you do that, when you honor God, you are making it possible for the food to go out, for the word to go out. You're making it possible today. Because you are generous givers, we do have the opportunity to utilize the internet. That stuff doesn't, it's not free. Yes, there are way more expensive ways of doing it, but the majority of that is free, but there are fees that we do pay. But everything that you see in that center section right there is paid for. We don't owe a dime on it. Okay? But here's the thing, that's because of obedience. That's because of obedience. And the blessings of God is on that. But look what he says here. So he says, not only will I pour out blessings on you, but I also will rebuke the devourer for your sake. And so if you look that word up, if you look up that word devourer, basically it just means anything that will consume. I remember hearing preaching early on. And here's the thing, and it was really quite funny because I began to believe it. If you don't tithe, God will get his money somehow. That's condemnation. Oh, well, if I don't tithe, then my car's going to break down. Or something will happen at the house, and God's going to get his money somehow. That is condemnation. That is condemnation. And let me tell you something. That is a preacher that is pimping his pulpit. Oh, I got one to agree with me. My wife agreed with me. I'm just going to tell you right now that if you're a preacher out there that's listening to this right now and you're using your pulpit to pimp people to give into your ministry, there will be answers. Anyway, I'm just saying. That just came up. I'm just sorry I got to say it. But he says, I'll rebuke the devourer. I don't understand, other than the fact that it doesn't matter when you honor God, he blesses it. And he says, now I'm going to rebuke the devourer. In other words, it's pretty simple, and I've explained it to my children this way. You've got a hole in your pocket. How many people have ever put coins in your pocket, and they fell right out and ended up in your shoes? You know what God will do? He'll take that pocket and he'll sew up that hole that all that money's falling out of. When you choose to honor God and you do what he says, he'll sew up that hole in your pocket.
I don't understand. All I know is that God blesses, and then there's always enough left over when I honor God. When I begin to honor God, and we sold out, and those that have heard our testimony know how I come and I put my wallet, and she put the checkbook up there on the altar, and we said, God, we don't understand how you're going to do it, but you're going to do it because we're trusting you, and we're going to begin to honor you. And we started doing that, and it was very little at first. I don't even remember. It was probably $20. And I had the mentality of, I need that $20. I need that $20 to do this with. Now, before that, it was, I want that $20 to go buy beer with. But when I started honoring God, even then, I had the mentality of, God, I need that $20. It's real easy to wait until all of your bills are paid and then write a check at the bottom. It takes faith to write a check first and then say, okay, God, this is what's left. I got all these bills to pay. Now, I'm not saying go out and just rack up all kinds of debt and then expect God to pay your bills. That ain't honoring God. I believe that there's some stewardship that goes with this, and that we do need to be good stewards. We need to learn to honor, not only honor God, but also live according to our means. Listen to me. A mindset of poverty has nothing to do with a dollar amount. It's got nothing to do with whether I've got $15 in my bank account or if I've got $1,500. It has nothing to do with that. Okay? Honoring God is just trusting God with everything you have, regardless of that number. But look here, because here's the thing is, I don't believe that he just wants to rebuke the devourer. I believe that he wants to bless you. I really, truly believe that. He wants to bless you, but it takes obedience to have the blessings of God on your life. And here's the thing, I've heard people say, oh, you know what, preacher? What you say is great. It sounds awesome. But all that tithing stuff is Old Testament. It's Old Testament stuff. That's in the law. I'm going to show you a scripture here in just a minute that Jesus himself spoke. That's New Testament. If you don't know Jesus, the words that are in red in your Bible are New Testament. And Jesus said that it should be done. I'm just telling you. In fact, I'll just go ahead and tell you what it is. Put Matthew 23:23 up there. Jesus was talking to the scribes and the Pharisees in this verse of Scripture. In fact, in Matthew chapter 23, he was saying, I believe it's seven woes. He was telling the Pharisees and the Sadducees all these different, woe is this, woe is that. This is one of them. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites! For you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving out the others undone. He's saying, you pay tithes off of your spices. In other words, you are getting down to the nitty-gritty. You're paying particular attention to the little bitty things, and you're neglecting the weightier things. Jesus was just giving them a teaching of saying, you're doing this, but you're not doing this. You're being a hypocrite. You are a double-minded man. And he says, in James, he says, a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. You say, this is important, but this is not. You see, here's the thing is that I talk to Christians, people, children of God, that believe, oh, I should not have an adulterous relationship. Well, why shouldn't you have an adulterous relationship? Well, because it's in the Bible. Okay, that's good, that's good. That's in the law. We don't live under the law. We're under grace, right? We are under grace. Now, listen, you shouldn't have an adulterous relationship. I'm just telling you now, okay? It's immoral, and it dishonors God. Okay, what about stealing? Have you ever stolen anything in your life before? Does that honor God? No, it doesn't honor God, but that was under the law, though, Frenchie. We're not under the law. We're under grace. Is it okay? I mean, really, because we're not under the law. It's not okay, right? It's not okay because it dishonors God. It's immoral, right? I mean, right, I heard something about a neighbor. Do I really have to love my neighbor even if they play loud music? I mean, but see, the word says to honor thy neighbor. In fact, Jesus even says, honor thy neighbor as thyself. But see, that's under the law. I mean, we don't live under the law, right? I mean, that's our argument. We don't live under the law. We live under grace. The grace of God. Come on, y'all. But it all, I mean, it doesn't say, you know, one of the ten, you know, Moses didn't come down off of the mountain, thou shalt tithe. And I could take you, listen, if we had enough, I mean, if we had enough time in this day, I could take you through the Word of God and show you that tithing was in the Word before the law was given. I could show you all the way from the beginning in the Word where tithing was in the Word long before the law was given. And again, in Matthew 23:23, and that's just one. This is just one verse of Scripture in the New Testament. There are many in the New Testament that talk about honoring God with the tithe. But in Matthew 23:23, God, Jesus said, don't neglect it. You should do it all. Not only tithe, but you should also think about the things that it mentions there, the weightier things, justice, mercy, faith. That's what he says. These you ought to have done without leaving out the others. In other words, they should all be important. I asked you this question at the very beginning because I'm fixing to explain why. Do you want the blessings of God in your life? Yes, I do want the blessings of God on my life. And I pray that you want the blessings of God on your life. What happens when you are obedient and do what the Word says? Think about this just for a minute. Because when I tell you this, I pray that if you don't already have the blessings, you want the blessings. And we're not going to look at the Scriptures. You can study it on your own time. But do you remember the story in Matthew 14 when Jesus fed the 5,000? In that story, Jesus was teaching. Actually, he was trying to get away from the people. He was trying to pull back from and to have a prayer time, personal time with the Father. But the people heard where he went, and so they started walking to where Jesus was. And this crowd of people shows up, and he begins to teach. And then it starts getting dark, and the disciples are like, hey, Lord, look, we don't have any food in the pantry. Well, technically, really, we only have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and there are thousands of people here, so they need to go to McDonald's and buy them some food. Just tell them to go home, Lord. That's kind of what they said, sort of, you know. And Jesus said, what do you got? And they said, well, we've got 5 loaves and we've got 2 fish. And he says, okay, tell them all to sit down. Bring me what you got, right? And they said, wait a minute. No, you didn't hear what we said. We've got 5 loaves of bread and we've got 2 fish. And there are 5,000 men plus the women and the children. We really don't even know what the real number is. I just know it was a lot. And Jesus said, bring me what you've got. I want you to hear what I'm about to tell you. Bring me what you have. They brought him the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. And do you know what he did next? He blessed it. He broke the bread and he blessed it. And then he gave the broken pieces back and says, now go feed the people. They didn't have enough. You need to hear what I'm saying. They did not have enough. But when they brought what they had, and he blessed what they had, they had take-home dinners. They had 12 baskets full to go home with. They went home with doggy bags when God blessed what they had. But you see, it required obedience on their part. It required them to bring what they had so that he could bless it. And once he blessed it, he said, now go feed the people. I want you to think about that. Look, I'm not trying to fill the treasury and all this kind of different stuff. I want you to be, if you are, I don't think you are, but if you are bound up by this, I want you to be free. Because this is what Jesus will do. He will break that chain off of you. That chain of, in other words, that mentality of I don't have enough. Listen, I'm telling you this because I have been guilty of saying, I don't have enough. I don't have enough to do this. I don't have enough to do that. I've told my children, stop doing that. I'm going broke taking care of you. And I think we should be smart. I think we should be. But it's a mentality. It's a mentality of saying, I don't have enough. Because I don't really care how much you think you have. You still don't have enough. In the real. I'm just saying. I'm just throwing that out there. But when you give it to God, you've got more than enough. Am I the only one? Is Tina and I, are we the only ones that see that? No matter what that dollar amount is. We probably all said it. You're going to spend what you make. Right? I mean, you're going to spend what you make, right? I've said it. But regardless of what the number is, I can give to God everything that I've got up front, and I can honor God with that. And I can say, God, I'm not only bringing you my tithe. Well, it's not really mine. It's yours, God. I'm not only returning what is yours, because that's what the Word says. I'm not only returning what is yours, but I'm bringing everything else. That's all the offerings. That's everything that's there. And I'm saying, God, would you bless it? Because when your blessings are on it, I have more than enough. It doesn't matter if it's $20, if it's $100, if it's $10,000, whatever's in your bag, it doesn't matter. God, I'm bringing every bit of it to you. And I'm asking you to bless it. And when you let him bless it, you've got enough. And not only do you have enough, you've got left over. And I have begun to see that. I mean, I haven't begun to see it. I've been seeing it for a long, long time. I'm just telling you of the freedom, the liberty that Tina and I have. And she'd be the first to tell you, yeah, he used to be a Scrooge. He wouldn't give nothing. He was like, I would hold on to that stuff. And, you know, and it's like I was doing what I could. But the thing is when, hello, God used my wife to open my eyes and my ears to understanding. And I began to see what she had been taught as a little child. And then when I saw that and I saw the liberty that I had as a giver, that when we started honoring God and we started giving, the liberty that we had in that and what God is doing now. And so now I'm just letting you know. I'm not going to tell you who it is and what the dollar amounts are, but we began sowing seed into other ministries that we know are blessed, believing God for debt-free. Okay? And you say, well, what does that mean? I mean, why wouldn't you take that money and put it towards canceling your debt? I am. I'm putting it into the kingdom of God. So what does that mean? Does that mean that a ministry is going to come and they're going to write a check and they're going to pay off all your debt? Or they could if God wants to do that. I'll give you my address. I'll give you the account numbers. But I'm just saying that through that wisdom, there's always enough left over. And we've started doing things. And I told her this. I called her on the phone one day, and I said, you know what? I heard in my spirit, God says, do for others what you want done for yourself. And so we started doing that. We started doing for others what we want to see happen in our own life. And I cannot explain to you the multiplication that is taking place as a result of the blessings that are on what you bring to God. We honor God with all of it. We don't just honor God with the tithe. We honor God with the tithe, the offerings, the surplus, and it's not just the finances, but we honor God with everything that we have. If it's a possession and God says give it away, then that's what we're going to do. Whatever it is, we're going to honor God, and God blesses that. And I just pray that you'll see that today, because that is, I believe that that is the heart of God. I want you to think about this, and I'm going to close with, I'm not even going to read no more scripture. I'm just going to close with this right here. Let's stand to our feet, because I want you to hear this, because I truly believe this is the heart of God. When we trust God with everything, God blesses it. God was a giver from the very beginning. God was a giver from the very beginning. God gave His only begotten Son. If you read further in that Leviticus chapter 27, you'll see a verse of Scripture that talks about first fruits. First fruits is what, and it honors God. It is awesome. And all throughout the Word of God, God talks about first fruit offering. The firstborn is a first fruit. God gave the first fruit. He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish but have eternal life. He gave everything. I love the song, and me and Thad have talked about this before, the song that Corey Asbury sings about that He gave, He bankrupted heaven on our behalf. He gave everything. He didn't just give the first. He didn't just give Jesus. He gave everything for one person, for you, for you, for you, whatever. He gave everything for us. We can go through a slew of scriptures. While we were yet sinners, He gave His only begotten Son. He gave when I didn't know Him, when I didn't want Him, when I didn't desire anything. He gave. He gave in hopes that I would come to Him. I mean, God could have sat up there in heaven and said, okay, I know this person is going to reject me until their eyes are closed on this earth. They're going to reject me. So I'm not giving my son for that person. But that's not the God that we serve. What about Judas? Do you think that he knew that Judas was going to betray him? Absolutely he did. But you know what? We see opportunity after opportunity in the life of Judas, where Jesus gave him chance after chance after chance to turn from his ways and to honor God. Why would God put someone with the mentality of Judas in charge of the money? Do you know that that is what drove Judas to betray Jesus with money? Why would you? And we can read story after story. Judas was in, he was furious with Jesus because because of the amount of money that perfume or something, or when the woman anointed Jesus' feet, he was furious over that. We could have sold that perfume, Jesus. We could have put that money into the treasury. That is a mentality of poverty. I don't have enough. I don't have enough. I don't. I can't. I'll never. I work hard. I'm working. I got to go work more, so I can have more. That is a poverty mentality. I'm not saying you shouldn't work hard. I'm not saying you shouldn't do what you do. I'm just saying that when you choose to put that above what God will do for you, He says, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. All these other things will be added unto you. Listen, folks, I'm just saying, God is a generous God. He is a lavish God. You cannot outgive God. I heard preachers say that. I used to hear Charles say that all the time. You can't outgive God. You can't outgive God. I love trying. Because the more I give, the more He outgives. I'm just saying, I love it. It's fun. It is truly fun to honor God. Father, I thank You for this opportunity to share Your Word. I thank You, God, that You did. You bankrupted heaven on my behalf, me.
person, because every single person on this planet can say that. You bankrupted heaven for me, God. You've been a giver from the very beginning. And God, when we see what it does when we are obedient to you, not just in that area, but every area of our life, God, when we are obedient to you and we see the blessings that you put on that obedience, and like you said in Malachi, you also will rebuke the devourer for our sake. Father, I know that there's many things in our life that we put our attention to. We focus our attention, whether it is entertainment, whether it is our lifestyles, our jobs, our children, our grandchildren. Father, your word says there should be no other gods. I wonder how many people have higher priorities than you. There shall be no other gods before me. Father, I pray that as people hear this message today, I pray that we would see the blessings that come when we honor you with our life. I can't even really explain the multiplication that takes place when we honor you. When we come to the house and we choose to sit under your word, the multiplication of time, the multiplication of blessings, the multiplication of talents, the multiplication. God, you are a multiplication God. And so, Father, I thank you today that I believe that you are going to multiply this word because I was obedient to share the word. Even though it's not a popular subject with folks, it's not a popular subject with people, but God, it's important to you that we would be obedient to your word, that we would honor you, that we would glorify you in everything that we have and everything that we do. So God, right now, I just thank you for what you're going to do through this. For this word, the word that has gone out, you said your word will not fail you in Isaiah 55:11. God, it will do what you sent it out to do. And I believe that your word was intended to be multiplied. And God, when we are obedient to you, you do multiply it. Lord, it's like a seed that goes in the ground. It's like I'm seeing right now that one single acre goes in the ground. And that seed breaks open. And it produces a mighty oak tree. And in that one seed is a multiplication of many seeds. So, Father, I just speak over this house. I speak over every person that is watching this. God, that there would be a massive multiplication of this word today. And God, that we would turn around and we would sow this seed into other people's lives so that they could be set free from the bondage of the mindset of poverty. God, I believe that it's done. I believe it right now. I believe that people have heard it today and their eyes have been opened. I believe that their eyes have been opened to see all this time. And God, that we'll walk in the blessings that you have for us. God, I give you the thanks and all of the glory in the mighty name of Jesus. If you're in this house today and you say, Pastor, I need prayer, we're going to have communion here in just a second. Everyone should have been given the little communion cup. We're going to have communion. But if you're in need of personal prayer and you say, Pastor, I need you to agree with me. I just need you to pray about this matter or whatever it is. I want to stand in agreement with you before we take communion. If you want to come to the altar, you can freely come to the altar. This is. You do not have to be a member of this church to come to this altar. Maybe, you know, you want to be distanced. That's fine, too. I have hand sanitizer. But sometimes it's important. I believe that the touch is important. The word says to lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Let me tell you something. COVID or no COVID, God did not give you the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. I believe, I truly, truly believe in being smart, but I also believe in not being ignorant. So I'm just telling you today that if you're in need of prayer, I will pray with you and I will agree with you. If you have never received Jesus as your Savior, I want to invite you today. Receive Him as your Savior today and make Him the Lord of your life. Give Him control. Give Him control of everything. That's what Lord means. Give Him control. And watch what God will do in your life. Watch how God will multiply in your life. But as they sing this song, then we'll take communion.